Thank you. Chào mừng các bạn đã quay trở lại với số trò chuyện cùng Đại học Western Sydney. Ngày hôm nay chúng ta sẽ cùng tìm hiểu bức tranh đào tạo và bức tranh việc làm của ngành truyền thông ở xứ chuột túi nha. Mời chị Trang cùng tham gia với chúng em về chủ đề này ạ.
Hello Mỹ, xin chào Mỹ, xin chào Team ISV và chào tất cả các bạn sinh viên cũng như là quý phụ huynh đang xem tiếp chủ đề trao đổi cùng trường đại học Western Sydney. Chương trình cử nhân truyền thông của trường đại học Western Sydney là một chương trình kéo dài 3 năm học thôi. Thì trong 3 năm học này, cái điểm đặc biệt nhất của mảng đào tạo về ngành truyền thông của trường Western Sydney đó chính là cái thứ nhất là nếu nói về xếp hạng chính thức thì ngành truyền thông của trường đại học Western Sydney được xếp hạng trên top 100 trên thế giới. Thì Western Sydney được nằm trong top 100 thì điều đó cực kỳ vinh hạnh đối với trường. Và cái thứ hai nữa là xét về thực tế thì cái cũng giống như là các chương trình đào tạo khác thì cái tiêu chí đào tạo của Western Sydney luôn luôn là để chuẩn bị cho sinh viên sẵn sàng cho cái cuộc sống công chức sau khi ra trường, tức là chuẩn bị cho các bạn là sẵn sàng để trở thành những người làm việc thực thụ, gọi là work ready. Các bạn sẵn sàng biết, các bạn đã biết trước là cái môi trường làm việc thực tế như thế nào, các kỹ năng cần thiết, và các bạn sẽ ứng dụng, thực hành, thực tập những kỹ năng đó trong suốt 3 năm học. Rồi đến khi mà ra trường thì các bạn vào việc thì các bạn chỉ cần làm việc luôn, chứ không phải là phải đợi công ty của mình phải có một thời gian thử việc để đào tạo lại nữa. Bởi vì thực tế mà nói, ở Việt Nam mình thì rất là dễ thương, mình đi làm là mình sẽ có 3 tháng thử việc đúng không, để được đào tạo, được chỉ dẫn. Nhưng mà ở bên Úc thì người ta, nhà tuyển dụng thì người ta quan niệm là bạn đã có một thời gian được đào tạo chuyên ngành chuyên môn rồi, thì khi mà ra trường, khi mà được tuyển bạn vào thì bạn sẵn sàng đóng góp cho công ty luôn. Nhưng mà về cái mặt này các bạn rất là yên tâm, bởi vì Đại học Western Sydney cũng tự hào được bình chọn là trường số 1 ở toàn bang New South Wales về cái tiêu chí là cái sự hài lòng của nhà tuyển dụng. Tức là các nhà tuyển dụng, các công ty ở cả bang New South Wales, nó có tới mười mấy trường rồi các bạn, nhưng mà họ đánh giá sinh viên tốt nghiệp từ trường Western Sydney là số 1 ở cả bang về cái tiêu chí là cái tính thích ứng. Sinh viên của trường có cái khả năng thích nghi rất là nhanh và rất là tốt. Cái thứ hai là họ đánh giá là sinh viên tốt nghiệp từ trường Western Sydney thì có cái kiến thức chuyên môn vững chắc hơn so với cái mặt bằng chung. Thì đây là kết quả khảo sát của Q's, là một cái tổ chức độc lập của chính phủ Úc để đánh giá những cái trải nghiệm của sinh viên, những cái chất lượng đào tạo. Thì trong suốt cái cuộc khảo sát từ năm 2018 tới 2016 tới 2018 á, thì Western Sydney luôn nhận được cái danh hiệu này. Trong cái chương trình đào tạo 3 năm này, trường sẽ chia cái chương trình cụ thể thành là 4 chuyên ngành, bao gồm có thứ nhất đó là báo chí, thứ hai là quảng cáo, thứ ba là PR và cái thứ tư là screen media, tức là dịch nôm na là truyền thông qua màn ảnh đó. Thì trong mỗi một cái chuyên ngành một thì mình sẽ học một cái bộ kỹ năng, ví dụ như là trong báo chí đi thì các bạn sẽ học cái kỹ năng làm sao để mà mình nhìn thấy trong những cái tình huống rất đời thường hàng ngày, những cái câu chuyện có thể là gây xúc động hoặc là gây mang tới cái sự giải trí cho người nghe, người đọc. Mình học cái cách để phát triển cái chi tiết mà mình phát hiện đó thành một cái câu chuyện, và mình học cái cách để sử dụng những cái công nghệ truyền thông khác nhau để cuối cùng là mình trình bày cái câu chuyện mà mình đã phát triển đó dưới dạng là một cái sản phẩm truyền thông. Và trong báo chí thì các bạn phải học một kỹ năng cực kỳ quan trọng, đó nữa là nghiên cứu thông tin, kiểm tra nguồn thông tin để xem là cái mức xác thực của thông tin như thế nào. Bởi vì cái cách đào tạo của Western Sydney với cái ngành truyền thông này á, ngành truyền thông là ngành có cái ảnh hưởng rất là lớn đối với cộng đồng đúng không, đối với cuộc sống, đối với đời sống xã hội, cho nên là ngoài cái chuyện mà giúp các bạn xây dựng được một cái bộ kỹ năng rất là cần thiết là kỹ năng quản lý thông tin, tức là từ cái chuyện là nắm bắt hiểu được cái thông tin quan trọng nhất tới cái chuyện là viết bài, xây dựng câu chuyện, edit, chỉnh sửa, hoàn chỉnh câu chuyện và sử dụng các công nghệ truyền thông để mà trình bày cái ý tưởng của mình á, thì các bạn cũng phải nắm được cái đạo đức nghề nghiệp, tức là phải đảm bảo cái sự chính xác của cái thông tin mà mình truyền tải ra. Và cái thứ ba nữa là một cái điểm rất là hay, mình rất là thích ở chương trình này của Western Sydney á, đó là trong năm 3 đó là năm cuối á, dù là bạn chọn chuyên ngành gì, quảng cáo, báo chí, PR và screen media, thì các bạn đều bắt buộc phải học một cái môn thực tập. Và cái môn thực tập này là trường sẽ tạo điều kiện cho các bạn trải nghiệm cái môi trường làm việc cụ thể trước khi ra trường, trước khi các bạn có thể là sẵn sàng đi phỏng vấn xin việc.
Em thấy bốn cái ngành này đều rất là thú vị, nhưng mà em cũng chưa có thực sự liên hệ được là không biết mình phù hợp với ngành nào. Rồi em cũng không biết là ban đầu là chọn chọn ngành như thế nào á, rồi sau này nếu mà em có đổi ý thì em có thể chuyển qua những cái ngành khác hay không, hoặc là ra khỏi ngoài cái communication luôn?
Tính linh hoạt cái nó cho phép em làm tất cả những điều đó. Trong 3 năm học á thì trong năm nhất hầu hết là mình sẽ học những cái môn chung của ngành truyền thông. Những cái môn chung của ngành truyền thông, những cái môn căn bản, những cái môn gọi là nhập môn. Cái thứ hai nữa là mình học để mình biết được một ít là từng chuyên ngành nó dạy về cái gì. Những cái môn nhập môn của từng chuyên ngành, để mình có 4 cái nhóm chuyên ngành thì mình sẽ học được là cái nhập môn của mỗi chuyên ngành để mình biết được cái đại khái là mỗi cái hướng đi là như thế nào. Để bạn nào chưa biết rõ mình muốn gì thì mình sẽ có một cái như là thử gì đó, một cái task, một cái thử qua để mình biết được là mỗi một cái chuyên ngành là cái gì thì mình phù hợp thế nào hơn. Một cái thứ hai nữa là khi mà mình qua cái năm thứ hai là bắt đầu vô chuyên ngành chính á. Tức là sau khi năm thứ nhất mình xác định mình chọn chuyên ngành rồi ha, thì năm thứ hai mình bắt đầu vô học cái chuyên ngành chính. Thì cái năm thứ hai trọng tâm của nó là học cái chuyên ngành chính, thì để mà hoàn tất một cái chương trình cử nhân truyền thông với một chuyên môn nhất định thì mình phải học 8 môn trong cái nhóm chuyên ngành mà mình đã chọn. Nhưng nếu mà học xong năm thứ hai rồi mình mới thay đổi thì sao? Nếu lúc đó thì bạn chỉ có thể là đăng ký ví dụ như là chương trình bằng đôi chẳng hạn, ở trường nó cũng sẽ có kết hợp giữa Bachelor Communication với những cái ngành, những cái Bachelor khác, để các bạn có thể là mở rộng cái cơ hội nghề nghiệp của mình. Ví dụ như kết hợp truyền thông với kinh doanh, kinh tế, kết hợp truyền thông với nghệ thuật, kết hợp truyền thông với các ngành sáng tạo, design. Có rất là nhiều cái cho các bạn lựa chọn. Nếu như mà em nói là mình muốn ra hẳn cái ngành truyền thông luôn thì đó là một hướng ha. Còn nếu mà mình vẫn muốn ở trong ngành truyền thông nhưng mà mới ban đầu mình chọn Advertising, là học về quảng cáo. Học về quảng cáo tức là mình phải xây dựng được những cái chiến lược quảng cáo cho công ty, mình phải học cách liên hệ với khách hàng, mình phải đi qua những cái chặng của quảng cáo, như là từ xác định thông tin mình cần phải quảng cáo là cái gì, cái nội dung đó, content, rồi viết content, rồi liên hệ với khách hàng để check xem là như vậy thì có ok hay chưa. Nói chung là từng một cái lĩnh vực nhỏ cụ thể một trong cái công việc quảng cáo là mình đã được học qua, mình được làm qua, mình trải nghiệm qua, mình cảm thấy cái này chắc là không hợp với em đâu. Em rất là thích giao tiếp, rất là thích trao đổi, gặp gỡ mọi người, nhưng mà em phải bắt em làm một cái gì đó mang những cái tính chất chính xác, như là tìm hiểu thông tin về sản phẩm thật là cụ thể kỹ càng để mà lên được một cái chiến lược truyền thông, rồi phải đi chiều chuộng khách hàng trong cái quá trình làm việc á, thì em không có làm được chẳng hạn như vậy. Em thấy là em phù hợp với lại mảng ví dụ như screen media hơn, tại vì screen media là em sẽ học truyền thông màn ảnh, mà em sẽ viết script, em sẽ viết kịch bản, em sẽ học cách quay phim, em sẽ học cách dựng phim, em sẽ học cách sử dụng cái phòng kỹ thuật để kiểm soát cái quá trình mà tạo thành một cái bộ phim, một cái video này kia như thế nào. Em sẽ học cách xử lý hậu kỳ, và tất cả những cái facility, tức là những cơ sở vật chất mình học á, là trường cung cấp sẵn ha. Phông xanh, rồi máy quay, rồi cả máy chụp hình là trường cũng phải trang bị cho các bạn. Các bạn, một bạn là năm 2 là lỡ chọn advertising quảng cáo xong, thấy các bạn học của mình á, học screen media hay quá, hết năm 2 rồi mới nói là không, em quyết định em không theo advertising nữa, em muốn học screen media. Vậy thì trong năm thứ 3, các bạn sẽ còn không gian, các bạn sẽ còn một số môn elective trong năm thứ 3 và môn tự chọn hay tập trung trong năm thứ 3. Thì các bạn sẽ chọn những cái môn elective đó trong mảng là screen media. Và nhớ là trong năm thứ 3 có cái môn thực tập á, thì thay vì là mình thực tập ở cái mảng là advertising thì mình thực tập ở screen media. Ví dụ như mình vẫn muốn trong ngành này thì nó có gọn trong 3 năm, còn mình thấy tới năm 2 này mình muốn nhảy qua hẳn qua ngành khác thì chắc là mình chỉ có cái cách là mình sẽ chọn là bằng đôi, hoặc là thậm chí là trường của Thanh Sydney nó cũng có những cái chương trình là bằng cử nhân độc lập mà chỉ có 1 năm thôi, nên là nó thêm 1 năm top up cho mình thêm một cái bộ kỹ năng bên ngoài cái lĩnh vực mà mình đã học nữa, thì nó rất là linh hoạt. Thì những cái thông tin vừa rồi là những thông tin khá là mang tính chất lý thuyết mà chị được biết, còn bây giờ thì đến cái buổi trao đổi giao lưu của chúng ta ngày hôm nay thì mình cũng mời được cô Asha, là cô phó khoa của khoa xã hội nhân văn và nghệ thuật truyền thông, cũng như bạn sinh viên là Tina, là bạn từng là cựu sinh viên của trường học về cử nhân truyền thông chuyên ngành báo chí. Thì đây sẽ là những người thật việc thật, những chuyên gia mà có thể trả lời những cái câu hỏi thắc mắc của Mỹ và của các bạn tốt hơn.
Hello
Asha.
Hello.
Thank you for spending time with us. Hello Tina.
Hello, how are you?
Chào mừng Tina đến với buổi nói chuyện ngày hôm nay.
Tina, I know that you can speak Vietnamese, so I would love to have you speak something in Vietnamese to say hi to our audience.
Yes, definitely. Chào quý vị và các bạn. Hôm nay Tina sẽ làm phỏng vấn này nói Lúc khi nào học ở Western Sydney University trong năm 2011 tới cuối năm 2014. Tina có biết nói tiếng Việt chút xíu mà không có hay. Thì hôm nay cái phỏng vấn này Tina sẽ nói tiếng Anh.
Rất là cute.
Mời các bạn và quý vị coi và lắng nghe. Cảm ơn nhiều. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina. Actually, I'm so proud of you.
I am so proud of her. I wish I could also speak in Vietnamese, but I would like to say greetings from Sydney to all of you watching and listening in today. We are so happy to have you on board and happy to answer any questions you may have today for us.
Thank you. We love to have you here because we like to have a vivid picture from first-hand experience. And so let's start with Dr. Asha. Well, it's very inspiring for me to learn that just like Dr. Yi Chen, the Vice Provost of Western Sydney University, you started out as an international student at Western Sydney University, right?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, so I'm really curious to learn about your journey to where you are today. So now you're very well established in both industry and in an academic institution. Could you share with us your journey from the start and also why journalism?
Thank you so much. Look, my career in journalism started back in Fiji where I was born. And soon after high school, I started working as a journalist. I had no idea then that I'd ever sort of land in Sydney in Australia and live here. But I got my education, high school education, and started working as a journalist. And then from there, I got to travel a lot, I must admit. I covered the 1997 Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Scotland. And then that was more like a turning point because that's where I was sort of basically training for the kind of journalism I was doing. And when I came back to Fiji, I basically already had secured a sort of permanent residency status here in Australia. And so in 1998, we arrived in Australia. I arrived here in this country without any plans. I didn't have a job. I didn't have anything to go to. Just three suitcases, three children and a husband. And
wow,
had to start from scratch. But I must admit that it was my journalism career, my belief in journalism and the belief in my ability to use my skills and find where that I was able to establish myself. So I started studying at Western Sydney University.
Wow.
So there's no beginning or there's no ideal time to start learning. You can start your education depending on your own personal circumstances. But I think for young Vietnamese students, and I did this to my own children, I say to them, when the opportunity is there for you to learn, please take that opportunity and make use of it. Because through education, you are able to improve not only your own life, but you know the lives of people around you. Inspire so many people. Thank you.
Well, I believe that this is not something you see or you saw on Tina as well. As I know that Tina is a former student of yours at Western Sydney University and that has gone to pursue a fascinating career in communication in Sydney. So, Tina, could you share with us your story regarding your passion and how you started out and you get to do what you're doing now?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you for having me. I guess just to start with, growing up, I really enjoyed writing and English. I did so much better in that subject than I did mathematics. So I figured, you know, what can I do or study to, I guess, allow myself to work in a job that requires writing in the future? And after some research, I decided to do the communications course at Western Sydney University. And so I did the 3 years that, you know, you have to do to get the bachelor's degree. And by the end of my third year, I felt like I wasn't ready to leave the study environment just yet. And luckily, I was offered a spot on the fourth year honours program, which basically, lets students spend a year to pursue a, I guess, a topic of research. And for me, it was a great opportunity to get a bit personal And so I explored how young Vietnamese Australians like myself in Western Sydney live between two cultures. You know, one culture, obviously Vietnamese culture at home, for example. And then the second culture is Australian culture that you live in outside of the home. And yeah, by the end of the fourth year, I found that that gave me a bit more experience, but also to, I guess, build on my personal and professional growth. And by the end, I was ready to kind of start working. And yeah, after university, I kind of fell into the advertising industry. Knowing that I still wanted to write, I took up a job as a junior copywriter. Mm-hmm. And pretty much started from there. And between then and now, I've also worked at a travel agency, you know, doing their in-house marketing and communication.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, that gave me a lot of experience on the job, but also just being able to explore the world a bit more. And today I work in Sydney for an advertising agency called Media Merchants. I'm the digital content writer there. So pretty much anything that's written or content that our client needs, I'm the one that kind of works on it. Yeah, I specialize in retail mainly, but you know, I could be potentially working across a lot of brands and products as well, which is quite fun and keeps it a bit interesting.
Yeah. So how did you know Asha? So she used to be your teacher, or she's your supervisor for that on a year?
Yeah. So Asha, from memory, Asha taught the journalism courses in the first 3 years. And then when I did my fourth year, Asha was also my supervisor. So
wow. Yeah, so that's why you two are so close until now.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just wanted to say Tina is now more like a friend to me. So we meet for lunches, we communicate, we talk about things. I really was very impressed with the fact that Tina came up with the idea to look at or compare the Vietnamese young people in living in Sydney and trying to negotiate their cultural identity, not giving up on the Vietnamese culture, and also trying to adjust and adapt in a new environment and adapt to the Western way of life. It was a really rich research. And by the time she was finishing off her fourth year, she already had a job lined up.
Oh,
and look at her today. She's a very accomplished professional woman, I'd say, who owns her own property. She lives, can I say this, Tina? She's living because she's bought her own house, and she's able to easily travel to work from where she's living. But in the weekends, she packs her bag and drives her car and goes and visits her family and spends the weekend.
So sweet.
And yeah, and then Monday she commutes to work, you know, and 5 days she works. And like she goes away for a retreat to her family in the weekends. And what a lovely life.
Thank you, Asha.
That's so heartwarming. Also, I could have a glimpse of how financially rewarding jobs in this field is.
Yes, it is really rewarding. And like I let Tina speak, but like, you know, she studied journalism. But like Trang said when she did the translation about our degree, the thing is, it's a very versatile degree. You can't lock yourself into one thing. You can do a whole variety of things. And those are the kinds of possibilities you can explore through this degree. So we teach, like Tina did or learned about journalism. So she majored in journalism, but she could handle public relations because public relations requires you to be able to tell a story, to prepare a message and do a strong pitch and all. You do that in journalism too. But she's working in managing advertising copy, which means that it involves a lot of marketing, a lot of strategizing. But journalism teaches you all these skills. The fact that, you know, you are able to pick up on an idea, develop it, present a story around it. So storytelling is more like a requirement, a perennial attribute to have. The fact that you can tell a story as a journalist, you can tell a story as an advertising copywriter, and you can really market it well. And Tina is really doing all of that really well. And the fact that she works with speed, she understands language, she understands the messaging of all of it. So again, we don't say to our students, oh, you do journalism, so you must go and work as a journalist. They can work as media advisors. Like I said earlier, some of our students work as media advisors to the Premier of New South Wales, to federal government ministers. They work in journalism as well. They work in corporate communications. One of our students is a news editor for Google, which is such a big high profile position. So they go into so many different fields of work, but they're still working in the areas that they want to work in. They love their profession, and you know, so they have the best of both worlds. They have the skills, they have the knowledge, but they also have the capacity to earn good money. And corporate communications is a big field. It's very lucrative, and you don't necessarily have to work in Australia. You can work in Vietnam and make a huge difference. There are so many businesses, corporations work on. And Tina, she can explain how she found her passion through sheer hard work. She was a very hardworking student and very driven as well. Tina, over to you.
I think for me, having that Vietnamese work ethic as well, like work hard to gain the result, that definitely did not go away. But yeah, I guess as a student, you know, you have to kind of make use of the opportunities, whether that's in the classroom or with your teacher, even in the library. I love spending time in the library. There were so many resources there. And just speaking to the librarian to figure out how things work and also how to find information. And, you know, just speaking to your classmates and seeing, you know, what different, I guess, experiences and opinions they have, it all just kind of gels together to kind of, I guess, be the university experience, whether that's you know, online or on campus. So, yeah, it's really important, I think.
Well, that's cool. So thank you for your sharing. Now I started to have some input to put together the profile of the person who would choose to study in communication. So based on Tina's story, maybe I would need a passion for writing, and some topic is really close to my heart that I want to be heard, and then the dedication, the focus on the detail and hard work. Is it correct?
I mean, there was a lot of questions in that question, but I guess personally for me, yeah, I wasn't too sure what I wanted to do after studying, but it was just more that I found that as long as you work hard, you know, be true to yourself, build the confidence and go out and get the experience, anything's possible. Like, don't limit yourself to just being in the one box or the one category. You know, I knew that I loved writing, so journalism was just kind of my way there. But now, you know, I love being in the advertising industry. It's a bit more creative. You can work with a range of people. You know, there's just so much to kind of get your hands into. And, yeah, you just figure it out along the way. I think it's a growing, I guess, process all the time. You're always learning new things about the world and yourself. So I hope that answers the question.
Just to add to what Tina has just said, look, and what we encourage our students to do, especially even in the journalism area, is that, look, you have to value what you have. So we get our students to write stories that's very close to their heart as well. Just last semester, in my online class, and they've come up with the most beautiful story ideas, because these are stories from their home environments, from their private spaces, where grandmother has got a special remedy for the cough and the cold, and that has worked. Or grandmother knows some really great recipes, foods that would that can be preserved, say, for example. And actually, to be really honest with you, these kinds of stories are really valued in the world today. And of course, you don't have to go far to tell those stories. You can do a little YouTube clip on that story get grandmother into the frame of your video and get her to narrate that story. She may speak in the Vietnamese language, but you know a bit of English and you can translate it. And those videos can go viral. So the whole field of communication is full of opportunity. You just have to come up with ideas and come up with original ideas, and we help you to enhance and add value to your ideas, and then you can go in the direction that you choose to go into.
Thanks, Asha. And from your sharing, we can understand that the job's respect for communication is really good. Like your student used to work like a media advisor for the government, or like Tina, you started with journalism, but now you end up with copywriter, content creator. One of the areas that the young people, you're crazy about, they love to do so. Could you share a bit about what kind of step, a typical media company in Australia will require the applicant to go through before they can recruit you?
Okay. Some big media organizations, for example, will have like a application process. So you would have to create an account, submit your credentials, and then answer questions. And then once you do get an interview, they might ask you to do like a sample test. So for me, for example, when I went in for the first interview, they asked me to, write some copy based on the brief that they provided. So you might end up with on the spot tests to kind of show what you can do, in that, particular instance. And I think that's important as well, because that's a great time for you to show your skills and experience.
Could you tell me a bit about what Asha just said earlier, that when you was in your older year, jobs was lining up for you?
I'm just trying to remember what has happened years ago. But in my third year, though, definitely in my third year, I did a placement. That was for about 3 months. Yeah, like a paid internship.
Did you find it yourself, or did the school give it to you?
I think I found it myself. It might have been from the school's careers office. So they
the career hub.
They might have it on there, and you just apply yourself. Luckily I was able to get it. Yeah, basically those 3 months, I think that definitely helped to kind of build the experience bank that I have, which made me a bit more employable than someone else perhaps. Like you said, my fourth year, most of that though was just the research component for the honors year. But after that, I got my first job within a few weeks. Like for me, I found it really easy. So basically just work hard, have some experience, get that while you can, while you study, and then the rest, it's fairly easy. So
okay.
I found it anyway.
She sounds very modest, Dr. Asha. It's like it's there must be something else besides being lucky or being hardworking. What do you think?
Look, I totally agree. She's being very modest here. I remember how she got her paid internship for 3 months. So for our internship program, we get our students to do 105 hours of industry placement, which is supervised by the academic from the area, like journalism, advertising, PR, and screen media. And then, of course, the industry partner also supervises the student. But in Tina's case, she found the placement through Careers Hub, which is a very important element of Western Sydney University. And then it was a paid placement. So she was getting paid, and she did more than 105 hours because they really loved the work she was doing, and they wanted to keep her on, and they were paying her. And so that became an advantage. So when she went for her proper job interview, where she started working, stepping out of university after she graduated her honors, it was so much easier for her. And this is what happens to really good students, meaning students who work hard, who are really dedicated, who really have direction and know where they want to be. We facilitate that as academics as well, because we also have contacts in the industry. Like I said earlier, in New South Wales, Western Sydney University is number one choice for employer satisfaction because our students come from diverse backgrounds. Just recently, a couple of weeks ago, I was on the interview panel with them when they were recruiting students as interns and for paid positions. And the specific criteria was students from diverse backgrounds, meaning students who know another language, students who come from a different cultural background. And our advantage at Western Sydney University is that we are located in the diversity capital of Australia, which is Western Sydney. Every community that migrates or every family that migrates to Australia chooses to live in Western Sydney. I have been teaching at Western Sydney University for 17 plus years. And so the students I taught 17 years ago, 10 years ago, are in very high profile positions like Tina is. And if Tina has a vacancy in her work environment, she'll come to me and say, Asha, there is an opportunity. Can you nominate a student? And this is how the world goes on. We push our students in that direction. And we use social media such as LinkedIn to connect with our students. So many of my students are working abroad in France, in Sweden, in the UK, in the US, in Asia, in Hong Kong, China, all over the world. And they connect with me and they say, oh, there's opportunity. This is what I'm doing.
Yeah. And Asha, I used to have a student told me that actually the fastest way to get a job or even a part-time job, an official or part-time job, so some job that related to what you study, is to perform really well, outstanding in class. So that's the teachers, the academic will, you know, notice you, and wherever there's a relevant opportunity, they will call you. So I think that's a very good tip.
That is a very good tip. Recently, I had a former student who is a senior producer for the 730 report, which is a flagship current affairs program at ABC, which is one of the top-notch programs. She's an executive, one of the senior producers there, and she's a former student of ours. She came to speak to our students. So she notices the other students as well. So the thing is, we notice the students, and of course, we will put the best students forward.
So Tina, it seems like you would like to ask something.
So I think, basically, like, as a student, you know, like I said before, it's not just what you learn in the classroom, I guess, content, it's what you experience outside, and just really getting out there and making things happen. You really have to get out there and experience it for yourself. Don't wait around for someone to give it to you. That's not how it works. And, you know, you will be rewarded down the track. Things will fall into place, whether you know it or not. Yeah, I think that's the one thing, if I could share, it would be that.
So, you know, content creator, and I think that it's required the people to work in this field have to be very creative, full of ideas, on day, every day, always the work in your head, always lights, 24 hours per day. Is that correct? So is there some time that you can't find any ideas for your job?
Yeah, so obviously one part of it is being creative. But also, you know, there will be times that I don't have ideas, but sometimes they will just come out of nowhere, which is great. Can't complain about that.
Yeah.
But I think also collaboration is quite key. So whether you know it or not, when you talk to other people, ideas are kind of buried there in those conversations. And just noticing things around you, whether it's, you know, like very small things or I guess larger issues or social change, for example. Yeah, so everything can kind of be interchanged and, you know, work together, and just ideas are everywhere. You just kind of have to go looking for it as well. And sometimes they come to you. So it's one or the other.
Yeah, right. That's correct. That's very true.
Right. I think while this webinar doesn't have the time we need to complete the story here, because it's the depth of it is really really deep.
Yes, I think. Yeah,
but it's time that we need to give the stage to our audience to ask questions to Dr. Asha and Tina. Okay, so among a lot of questions that we receive, I'd like to pick two to ask for Asha. A Vietnamese student asks, like, well, among four majors of the BCom program, could you please, from your own experience, place in order from most to least popular among international students?
Wow, you're putting me on the spot. Look, it's not about popularity. It's all about the fact that whatever you study, the relevance of studying the Bachelor of Communication is not lost. So if you study advertising, you are able to market, basically. But marketing is very much required, even if you do screen media. If you produce films or do documentaries, you really need those marketing skills from advertising. If you do journalism, you can't just operate in a silo and say, I've written the best story in the world, if you cannot take it and publish it and broadcast it. So you need the screen media skills to be able to package it in such a way. In a similar way, public relations, if you're studying public relations, you have to be able to tell a story about the information that you are managing. So you need the journalism skills. So it's a very mixed environment, and I can't say one is better than the other. All I'm saying, and this is look about independent learning, like we are an institution that focuses or that fosters student-centered learning, meaning the student is the center of attention. The students make those decisions. We are there as facilitators. I don't even call myself as a teacher. I say in this day and age, I facilitate the students' learning, and I can guarantee you, I can look in the eyes and say that once you choose that this Bachelor of Communication degree, you can't go wrong. You can use it in so many creative new ways, in so many fields of work and study.
Thank you, Dr. Asha. This is really assuring.
Thank you.
And a question for Tina. Was it fun to be a student at Western Sydney University? And how did you get the most out of your student life there?
Yep, so studying at Western Sydney University was really enjoyable for me. It wasn't stressful for me for some reason. I also created quite a few strong friendships, which is always a good thing. And yeah, I spent most of my time studying though. So that's the work ethic there. you know, for me, it was just like getting deep into the textbook and the content. And like while I did like, you know, I guess hang out with my friends and go to this event or that event, I think it's important as well to find the balance between studying but also experiencing what else is out there. So like we discussed before, like the careers office, or going to speak to someone or the careers advisor about, you know, what your worries might be or what you think the future holds for you. I think, yeah, it's really important to use the resources around. Even the librarians, like, they were great. Like, they're so knowledgeable and there's so much to discover. So, yeah, this is kind of the geekiness in me. But, yeah, I think university life, there's so much to it. You know, just take use of it. Don't always kind of be held back, I suppose. And yeah, it's the time really to kind of learn, but also develop who you are as a person, and who you might be, you know, in the future as well. Like just really putting that foundation down. Yeah. So.
Right. Thank you. Before we end the talk, do you have any final advice for the prospective students who are watching and who kind of have an idea to wanting to study this field?
I'll go first if you don't mind.
Yeah, please.
I think the world is a very evolving place right now, and I feel like if, as a student, if you are interested in a certain topic or, I guess, industry, really explore your options. and talk to someone. So whether you have, you know, the careers advisor or someone else who is working in a similar industry, really find out what it involves. And, you know, if you have the passion, you should follow it. It pays off. And, you know, you will end up being happy as well. Like, being paid to do what you like to do is great. It's amazing. It's a good feeling. And through that, you can then also give back to your community and to the world, you know, where that's possible. So, yeah, I think for students who are unsure, just really ask questions, explore. Don't be afraid to kind of go in a direction that you want to, even if people tell you not to. Yeah, it's really important to just to stay true to yourself as well and just go for it. Like, you only get one chance. So just go for it. Yeah.
Thank you, Gina.
Yeah, nice. Yeah. Touching. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tina. That was beautiful. I just want to add to that. Look, we're going through a global pandemic right now as this is being presented to you. What else can you do with your lives? Take on some study. And I also wanted to say that in our program, we have got people like experts or academics who will help you, guide you about, okay, if you study this unit, these are the requirements. This is what you can do with your life. And this is how you can advance your career. These are the work opportunities. These are the internship opportunities. So I wanted to end on that note. There's help available. And of course, Trang will share my email details with you. I'm happy to speak with anyone. I'm happy to even have a one-to-one Zoom meeting with prospective students if there are any doubts and you need.
That's lovely. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I think we ended this this talk on a really positive note for the viewers. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you. Thank you.
See you.
Take care.